I welcome you in the name of Christ, wherever you are. The Mobile Studio has moved back to Zion this week, and next week you'll see us at St. Andrew's United Church in Port Lauren. I'm the Reverend Sandra Jenkinson, and this is my husband, Reverend Fraser Williamson, who ministers at St. Andrew's and also at St. Paul's United in Golden Valley. And behind the camera today is Barbara Lee, and at the piano is Kathy Sylvester. Isn't it great? I got my hair cut this week. Hopefully some of you have been able to do that as well and are able to do that in the coming weeks as we start into phase two of reopening. Now, in the last week, the governing bodies of our churches have met, and even though churches in our area are allowed to reopen for in-person worship, all of our churches have decided to wait to reopen. And so at least until the end of July, we will still be providing this online worship service for all who wish to come together as the body of Christ. And of course, all of you watching are part of the body of Christ and part of this congregation, whether you attend here at Zion or St. Andrew's or St. Paul's, or maybe you're from Nipissing or Restuel or Magnetawan or Powassan or North Bay, or maybe you're even farther afield and outside of the Elmaguin area. Wherever you are, take a moment. Feel the Holy Spirit in your soul. Take a pause. Let it connect you through time and space to the body of Christ found here and now. And we open our worship today, as we do every week, by lighting the Christ candle. In the beginning, God said, "Let there be light." The light continued to shine through the ministry and teachings of Jesus Christ, and it continues even today through the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so we light this candle to represent God's holy light and pray that its flame carried within our hearts is reflected into the world through our words and actions. Amen.
And now I invite you to say along with us the call to worship responsively. Lord, you call us today to proclaim your presence.
We shout your name from the rooftops.
We resist the temptation to remain silent.
We will share our belief in you.
We risk being as foolish by an unbelieving word.
We will be laughed at and mocked.
We dare to share our witness of the life you have given us.
From the fire in our hearts, with praise and thanksgiving, we join now in worship and lift your name on high.
And let us pray. God of hope, wise, gentle, strong, you open a heavy door to reveal what is beyond. You prepare our trust account for when the material world collapses, freeing us from the need to know why things happen as they do. And building the bridge of humility we must cross to you. Dear God, may hope bring us a new day. Amen. And now for our first hymn. It is All Creatures of Our God and King. And it's found in your bulletins, but if you want to sing along in the hymn book, it's 217 in Voices United.
Hallelujah, hallelujah,
now, in our world, it is a time for confession. Sin destroys our lives. Sin destroys our relationships. Sin destroys our hope. But through faith in the saving death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our lives, our relationships, and our future are no longer enslaved to sin. Let us trust the love of God and confess our sin, that we might receive grace and find true freedom. Let us pray together the prayer of confession.
God of Abraham, Sarah, and Isaac, God of Hagar and Ishmael, who gave us your Son, Jesus Christ the Crucified, send your Holy Spirit to help us confess and truly repent of our sins. We turn against one another. We fail to care for the weak and poor among us. We pay no heed to the cries of the powerless. We seek our own advantage. Your Son emptied himself upon a Roman cross and revealed your eternal, self-giving love. Forgive us, merciful God. Wipe sin from our lives and let us find ourselves wholly in Jesus Christ, our Savior. It is in his name that we pray. Amen.
God, who loves us, does not abandon or forsake us. Our Savior hears and answers when we cry out from the wastelands of sin. Death cannot bind us, for the risen Christ sets us free. Hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. And now let us pray. Life-giving God, open our hearts and minds that we will receive and then act on your message of love, hope, and grace in your living word, Jesus. Amen. And now we go to Jim Murray, who is reading our scripture from Genesis today.
Hagar and Ishmael are sent away. When Isaac grew up and was about to be weaned, Abraham prepared a huge feast to celebrate the occasion. But Sarah saw Ishmael, the son of Abraham, and her Egyptian servant Hagar making fun of her son, Isaac. So she turned to Abraham and demanded, "Get rid of that slave woman and her son. He is not going to share the inheritance with my son, Isaac. I won't have it." This upset Abraham very much because Ishmael was his son. But God told Abraham, "Do not be upset over the boy and your servant. Do whatever Sarah tells you, for Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted. But I will also make a nation of the descendants of Hagar's son, because he is your son too." So Abraham got up early the next morning, prepared food and a container of water, and strapped them on Hagar's shoulders. Then he sent her away with their son, and she wandered aimlessly in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water was gone, she put the boy in the shade of a bush. Then she went and sat down by herself, about 100 yards away. "I don't want to watch the boy die," she said, as she burst into tears. But God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven. "Hagar, what's wrong? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Go to him and comfort him, for I will make a great nation from his descendants." Then God opened Hagar's eyes, and she saw a well full of water. She quickly filled the water container and gave the boy a drink. As God was with the boy, as he grew up in the wilderness, he became a skillful archer, and he settled in the wilderness of Paran. His mother arranged for him to marry a woman from the land of Egypt.
This is an interesting story from Genesis that we hear today. Last week, we heard about Abraham and Sarah and God's promise of a child for them. And Sarah laughed. But God promised them that through their son, they would give rise to a multitude of descendants, God's chosen people. And this week, the promise has been realized. Sarah has borne a son, Isaac, and they are celebrating with a feast. But all is not well in Abraham's household because he has another son, Ishmael, born to Sarah's maid, Hagar. Ishmael is not the chosen son. God promised Abraham that the chosen offspring would come through Isaac. So why do we even hear about Ishmael and Hagar? Why bother including this story of the unchosen son? I think this story is a timely reminder that the stories of people outside of our heritage and culture matter too. Unless you've been living under a rock for the last few years, you are familiar, I'm sure, with the phrase, Black Lives Matter. And one of the purposes of this movement is to bring awareness to white people that many, if not most, black people experience life differently than we do. And in that experience, black lives are valued differently, especially in terms of law enforcement and processes in the justice system. If we were to put it in biblical terms, Isaac and Ishmael are both Abraham's sons, but one is treated differently than the other. Isaac's story takes precedence in the biblical narrative, and we don't hear a lot about Ishmael. In our context today, much of the history and literature taught in schools focuses and is told from a white European settler perspective. And so that becomes the baseline and the norm, and things like laws and policies are based on that norm. But that leaves out or excludes other perspectives and other stories, other experiences, and other people. People who look different, are a different gender, of a different sexual orientation, people who don't fit the standard or the norm. So here we have this story about Hagar and Ishmael that reminds us that there are other people, other than the chosen ones, that have experienced God's grace and mercy. This story reminds us that lives that may not matter to those with power matter to God. Ishmael's mother is a foreigner, a servant with little to no power or agency. Even being the mother of Abraham's firstborn son doesn't save her from being sent away, probably to die in the desert just because Sarah is jealous or worried or just being plain mean. And so Hagar and Ishmael head out to that desert. The bread is eaten and the water runs out, and Hagar is so desperate that she leaves her son under a bush and sits a bow's shot length away so she won't hear his cries or see him die. Their lives are worth nothing to Sarah or even Abraham, because despite the text says he was distressed, Abraham still sends them off. And why would their lives really matter? Because, after all, they are not God's chosen ones. But their lives do matter. They matter to God. God hears Ishmael's cries and responds. God provides water and a promise to Hagar that God will make a great nation of Ishmael. The lives of Hagar and Ishmael matter to God. And just because their lives mattered to God, it didn't mean that God had forgotten about Abraham and Sarah and Isaac or that their lives didn't matter to God or mattered less to God. We know their lives mattered to God because the Bible is filled with their story and the story of their descendants. It's part of our faith story as Christians. But when Ishmael and Hagar were hurting, when they had been cast aside and treated badly by those who should have looked after them, God attended to them and made them a priority. One of the responses to the Black Lives Matter movement that quickly sprang up was the hashtag All Lives Matter. The argument was that it was wrong to single out any one racial or ethnic group as though their lives were more valuable or mattered more than others. But that's not what the movement was about. It is to bring awareness that Black people are hurting and have been hurting for a long time. And this needs attention, and all people are needed to bring about change and healing. Consider this story of Hagar and Ishmael. When they were hurting, God tended to them. Their lives mattered to God. But perhaps a better example is Jesus' parable of the Good Shepherd. When the shepherd takes off after that one sheep, it doesn't mean that the shepherd doesn't care about the other 99 sheep left in the pasture, but that one sheep who is in danger matters more at that moment to the shepherd than the 99 who are safe. Folks, our brothers and sisters and siblings who are not white are getting killed and arrested and treated badly in the justice system at this moment. These people include Blacks, Indigenous people, and other people of color. Their lives matter. They have families that are grieving. There is something wrong with our systems. And we need to face it, acknowledge it, and do better because their lives matter to God. And if their lives matter to God, they should matter to us. Because God's promises are not just to the chosen people. God's promises include those outside of the circles humans create for ourselves. Circles of race or class or culture or gender or sexual orientation. God created all people, knit each one of us together in our mother's womb. Each life is precious to God, and so these lives should be precious to us. We have work to do, friends. We need to educate ourselves outside of Facebook memes and rants. We need to speak up when it comes to racist or sexist or homophobic jokes or statements. We need to listen to and learn about stories of people who are different from us. We need to hear their voices. We need to work to make sure our laws and justice system actually work for all people, regardless of race or ethnicity or sexual orientation. This is hard work, but it is important work. It is the work of holy justice. Hagar's and Ishmael's lives matter to God. Black lives matter to God. Human lives matter to God. Your life matters to God. And so live into that precious gift by honoring and supporting the lives of others, especially those who are different from you. Amen.
And now for our next hymn, it's in your bulletins again, but if you want to sing along in the hymn book, it's 271, There is a Wideness in God's Mercy.
Justice, which is love and liberty.
And now we are at the time that is marked as the offering. And although the offering plate cannot be passed during online worship, there are many ways to still give offerings to your church. If you're not on PAR, which is pre-authorized remittance already, you can sign up and you can drop off or mail a check to your church, or e-transfer may be another option. Please contact your church's treasurer with any questions about your option for giving. I know for our three churches, I know the treasurers well, and they like it when money comes in. Your gifts help with the ongoing expenses of the church, as well as continuing to support mission projects, both at the local level and beyond, through the work of the United Churches Mission and Service Fund. Thank you for your faithful giving, especially during this time when we're doing church a little differently. And it will probably continue, and we will continue to do some online services later on. And while all financial gifts that help fund the work of the church are appreciated, we also remember that there are so many other gifts that also support the mission and work of the church. So at this time, let us virtually place all our gifts into the offering plate and lift it to God in thanksgiving for all that God gives us. Let us pray. Holy God, who gives life, nourishment, and strength to all creation, we thank you for the community of faith you have built, for your servants who have held fast to through the centuries, for the teachings and the witness of our ancestors, for the gospel's welcome to all in need, for the healing that comes from your watchfulness. Bless these gifts that all may be nurtured in truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we come to mission and work of the church. That's what it's called at St. Paul's and St. Andrew's. But I understand here at Zion it's just called the announcements.
Well, the life and work of the church.
Work of the church. But other places may call it the announcements. If you have another new way of explaining it, send me an email and I'll try using that. So for the Loring folks and the Golden Valley folks, the ladies' coffee hour will be on Tuesday at 10 a.m. Through Zoom, so please contact me to get the link. For Zion folks, will be another Lakeside coffee hour, so stay tuned for details in Reverend Sanders' email. And it's quite interesting how many coffee hours there are. Like, I'm about 80% coffee in my body.
Yes,
the water. So. And as well, thank you to everyone who sent in photos of their fathers for the prelude for today's worship. And happy Father's Day to all the dads and those who are father figures in our lives. May God bless them all. All of you watching the service today, as in the Passover weeks, are watching it on YouTube. And on average, there are about 120 views a week of the service, and some even outside of the country, and I know who you are. We are humbled that wherever you are, you find value in the message we offer every week. As we consider returning to worship in our churches, it may be that not everyone will be able to attend. And you might be too cautious about venturing out due to physical distancing rules. Not everyone will be able to fit in our sanctuaries. And therefore, Sandra and I would really love the option to be able to live stream services on YouTube. But we need your help. If you go to the YouTube and search for my name, Fraser Williamson, a photo of me will come up, and on the right-hand side of the screen, you will see a red subscribe button, sort of like the color of the hymn books. And please click on that subscribe button. And if we get 100 subscribers, we will be able to live stream worship services. And at this point, there are already 37 subscribers. So there's still only about, I guess that would put it at 63 more to go. So thank you for your help. And if you've been watching the services from near or afar and would like to make a contribution to one of our churches, we will be adding the mailing addresses for our three congregations in the credits of this video. This week, thanks goes to Kathy for the wonderful music, Barbara for running the camera, Jim Murray for reading scripture, and Ron Holotuck for the Minute for Mission. And now, speaking of Ron, you all like to see him, so here he is with this week's Minute for Mission.
The Minute for Mission for today is entitled Protecting the Children. Imagine growing up in a place of conflict where you live in constant fear of violence. This is what it is like to grow up in Gaza. As a church family, our hearts cry out for those who live in fear every day. Mission and Service supports this Defense for Children International, Palestine, which offers programs for children in that region. Members of the Abu R family were on their land across the street from their residence in the Zaytun neighborhood in northern Gaza. Around 6 p.m., a rocket struck the area, severely injuring 19-month-old Sabah Mahoub Habdan Abu R. The child died around 7:30 p.m. from extensive shrapnel wounds. Her aunt and the fetus she was carrying were also killed. A three-year-old sister and other family members sustained injuries. Based on evidence gathered from the scene, witnesses and experts, Defense for Children International Palestine concluded the blast was the result of a misfired rocket fired by a Palestinian armed group nearby and was not caused by an Israeli forces strike. Incidents like this one happen often in Gaza, Israel, and Palestine. Forces have been in conflict for decades. As in many conflicts, children are often the victims. We give thanks to the work of global partners like Defense for Children International Palestine, which offers programs for children to express in art what they are experiencing and activities that help them just be children. If Mission Service of Healing is already a regular part of your life, thank you so much. If you have not given, please join me in making Mission and Service Giving a regular part of your life of faith. Loving our neighbor is at the heart of our Mission and Service.
And now let us take some time for prayer. Let us pray. God of Hagar and Ishmael, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of all creation, we give you thanks that you created each one of us in your image. We give you thanks for the goodness that you share with us. We give you thanks for the times when you have provided love, justice, and compassion to us. We give you thanks for your presence in time of struggle. We give you thanks that you were present to us in Jesus, that you're present to us in the Holy Spirit. We give you thanks that even though at times we may seem divided, we are all connected to you, the God of love. We pray for the Hagars and Ishmaels in our world. We pray that their voices be heard, that they receive justice, and that they receive access to food, home, sustainable employment, and long lives of love. We pray for the Abrahams and Sarahs of the world. We pray that they gain understanding of the Hagars and Ishmaels of the world. We pray that they show understanding of them. and that they show compassion and show your love to those who are not like themselves. We pray that they understand the privilege they have compared to others. We pray for all those who've experienced the lives of Hagar and Ishmael, whether they are Black, whether they are Indigenous, whether they are part of the LGBT community. We pray for those who feel alone in this big world. We pray that there will be a time in which those who are different can be treated the same way as those who have privilege. You are the God who unites us, and we pray that we will work together to preserve your wonderful creation. We pray for the people who are standing up for the rights of those who are oppressed. We ask that you be with them in this movement that brings awareness and justice. We pray that this movement not only bring justice, but will bring peace to the world. And now we pray silently those persons or concerns, whether they are Abraham's, Sarah's, Hagar's, or Ishmael's, that we would like to declare to you. We gather all these prayers into one in the name of the one who taught us to love one another, Jesus Christ, who also taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now, friends, go forth with God's blessing and be a blessing to others. Go forth with God's love and love others. Go forth with God's grace and extend grace to others. And may you go forth secure in God's love and blessing, surrounded by the peace and mercy of Jesus Christ, and the joy and comfort of the Holy Spirit. May these all be held in your heart, now and always. Amen.
Amen.